If you're looking for ways to market or to make money off of your short fiction, then this episode is for you.
Welcome to the Stark Reflections on Writing and Publishing podcast. There has never been a better time for writers. More information, options, and opportunities are available to you, but navigating these requires insight. Join Mark Leslie Lefebvre as he draws upon more than a quarter century of experience as a writer, a bookseller, and a trusted book industry consultant to explore and reflect on the writing and publishing landscape to help you make informed choices on your writer journey.
Hello, Reflectives, and welcome to episode 97 of the Stark Reflections podcast. This is your host, Mark Leslie Lefebvre, and this episode is called 10 Tips for Marketing and Making Money Off of Your Short Fiction. Now, this episode is going to be all about short fiction, short stories. It may actually apply to those of you who have short articles and nonfiction, but for the most part, it is focused on short stories. But if you are a nonfiction writer and you're writing nonfiction articles, there are other ways you can apply some of these ideas into nonfiction, but the focus will be on fiction for the most part. And this is how you can market those short stories or make money off of those short stories. And that's going to be for a combination of ebook, print, and audio. And in the way I like to do, it's going to involve openness to hybrid publishing opportunities, meaning I'm going to take a look at traditional opportunities that exist for you to make money that way, as well as independent publishing and digital publishing ways to make money off of that fiction. Now, the topic for this episode comes via patron Maddie Dalrymple. Maddie recently sent a note to me via Patreon asking if I'd consider doing an episode covering this topic. Thanks, Maddie, for a most excellent recommendation, and thanks for being a patron of the podcast. Thank you, Maddie, and thank you to all the rest of the amazing patrons for sponsoring the show via your monthly contributions over on patreon.com/starkreflections. I hope you guys find value in the extra audio, video, and text content that you can get there for as little as $1 a month. Now, this episode is being pre-recorded because I'm just getting ready to spend a week at NINC, or Novelist Inc. in St. Pete's, Florida. And because I'm going to be in a hotel room, the audio quality isn't always great. And I know in particular in St. Pete's Beach, because it's Florida and this time of year and it's very, very hot and humid, the air conditioning system is constantly running and it makes a really horrible noise. And if you turn it off for more than 15 minutes, I end up sweating all over my keyboard when you don't want that, because that could just ruin things. In any case, because I'm going to be on the road and not in my regular recording space, I'm going to do this episode early so that it can be launched while I'm in the midst of Florida, while I'm enjoying Novelist Inc., and also while I am enjoying the heat and the wonderfulness that is NINC. This episode is sponsored by Findaway Voices, so let's hear a brief word about Findaway. Did you know that Findaway Voices now supports promotional pricing for a limited number of retailers, which are reflected on a promotion application that they send to their authors each month? Successful marketing and promotion strategies have long driven massive successes for ebook sales, but these tools haven't been available in the audiobook market. Well, at least not until Findaway Voices started offering them last spring. Now, authors who are publishing via Findaway Voices now have the opportunity for their audiobooks to be included in promotions that particular a la carte retailers engage in. And during the promotion, the list price that the author sets will be temporarily reduced, and the royalty is calculated on a percentage of the promotional list price that you set, which makes sense. Now, vendors will typically give titles that are on promotion in these price promotions more favorable coverage and merchandising support, particularly if your title fits into a relevant theme that they're promoting that ties in with a genre holiday, Halloween, Christmas, Valentine's Day, etc. Now, there are a few rules involved, so you have to have a title published via Findaway Voices and have generated at least one period of royalties on that audiobook. You have to have a promotional price during the promo that is at least 25% lower than the regular list price. And you can set the audiobook price to free, but there are certain retailers that have a floor of 99 cents. And so for those retailers, Findaway will send 99 cents instead of free. Now, I've just submitted a title to the November promotion list, and this, in my mind, is yet another great innovation for authors to earn additional revenue from their writing. And hey, that's what this episode is about, earning additional revenue from your writing. But you can learn more about Find a Way Voices and the amazing opportunities and innovations they're creating for authors over at starkreflections.ca/findaway. That's it for the introductory segment of this podcast. Let's get on to the main segment. Ten tips for marketing and making money off of your short fiction. Number one, selling the fiction to a traditional publishing market. Now, this goes back to the initial wisdom that I first received when I was a beginning writer, and the going wisdom was that in order to get an agent or a publisher interested in your work, you needed to first cut your chops in the short fiction market. And so you were advised to try to sell stories to magazines and other short fiction markets that were available, and then build a name for yourself up. And then once you had a name and had some publishing credits, then an editor or a publisher would actually take you seriously. So I'm going back to that in a way. I had started off with Writer's Digest books, and Writer's Digest has just been acquired by Random House. So I'm glad that that imprint is still available, because as a writer, I've long used so many of the books that they published, and some of them were the annual Writer's Market and the Short Story and Writer's Market guides. Now, they did have online markets available, but there's also one of the really consistent short fiction marketplaces out there is Rallin.com, and I'll have a link to that in the show notes. And what you're really looking for there is, with either the Writer's Market books or some of the online marketplaces like Rallin, is you're looking to filter by the genre that you're writing in, so different types of fiction or even nonfiction. And then you can kind of see the circulation. If it's a print magazine, if it's an online magazine, you sort of have an idea of the circulation numbers. You can kind of see the acceptance, like the length of fiction that they want you to submit, as well as what they pay. Now, I got to a certain point in my writing where I didn't want to send my writing off to any market that paid less than 5 or 6 cents a word, which is still considered professional rates for short fiction in the market. And when I started off, I mean, the very first short story that I sold, which came out in 1992, I received a contributor's copy of that magazine. It was sort of a digest-sized magazine that came out, and it came out on a quarterly basis. And I think the circulation was maybe 500 people. So as I sort of worked my way up to the higher and higher paying markets, I went, from payment in copy to 1 cent a word to, a penny and a half a word or 2 cents a word, eventually up to 5 or 6 cents a word. But there's still opportunities available for selling fiction to traditional publishing markets. There are still print magazines out there. You walk into any major bookstore or tobacco shop that has a large selection of magazines. You're going to find literary magazines. You're going to find genre magazines. And again, there's more online fiction markets as well. Like when the online fiction markets first came out, a lot of times they weren't paying markets, but now there are definitely some paying markets. There are paying markets for print fiction. There are paying markets for online fiction. There are even paying markets for audio fiction. And again, I'll include some links to some of those places in the show notes. And there are 7 different genres that are available in this area. So if you like writing short fiction and you have short fiction that you've written, there are still plenty of opportunities for you to actually get a check from some publisher, some editor, yes, out of some traditional sort of slush pile, where you can actually make money selling that fiction to a traditional publishing market. Number two, recycle, or reselling that fiction to reprint markets. So you sell your story for professional rights, which are 5 or 6 US cents per word. But then you get the rights back to that. And usually when you sign a short story contract, it's first North American serial rights, or first serial rights, or first world serial rights, or whatever. And the rights come back to you after a specific noted period of time. If the contract doesn't give you the rights back, it better be a really, really, really high payment. So typically, most short fiction contracts, the rights come back to you, so then you can resell that fiction to a market that buys reprints. Now, for reprints, they don't often pay professional rates. Maybe they pay semi-pro rates. Maybe they pay 3 cents a word. It might be 1 penny a word. It might be a flat fee even of $100 or $50 or even $10. It's less money than the original pro rates, of course, of 5 to 6 cents a word. But as Geddy Lee, lead singer for Rush, said to Bob and Doug McKenzie when he sang the song Take Off for their movie Strange Brew, 10 bucks is 10 bucks. Take off! You can do that multiple times. You can resell reprint stories, and I have sold plenty of stories multiple times. Sometimes I will take a reprint story, and that is when I will donate it to an anthology that is raising money for a particular cause. And here's the other benefit of short fiction. So this kind of goes with points one and two, is that in the way that indie authors use digital bundles and digital box sets in order to cross-populate their audiences, where, you know, somebody buys it because they want to get a book or story from author A, and then they discover the wonder of author B. Well, that happens when your story appears in anthologies. That happens when your story appears in magazines. So getting your work into these fiction, these traditional fiction markets, and oftentimes print, or even if they're online or audiobook, is yet another SEO exercise that's actually marketing you and your author brand. So again, you're using your fiction to market your author brand, potentially to make some money as well. And it's something you can continue to recycle, particularly in the print world, where the market for a particular readership might not cross over with another readership. But that kind of leads to the next point. Number three, selling fiction to foreign language markets. Canadian science fiction author Douglas Smith has sold fiction, short fiction stories, to markets that accept English language submissions, and then they translate them. So he's not paying to have the work translated. He's selling them to a market that will do the translation for him in foreign languages, in foreign markets. And this is something he started doing well prior to the internet ebook boom. Now, Doug's other language market short story sales have earned him between $30 and $300 per story. And again, because these are reprint stories where he's already made professional rates, this is that additional revenue. Now, it's worked out to Doug that he averages about $100 per sale to the foreign language markets. But in terms of marketing, Doug's stories have appeared in the same markets, translated to other languages alongside and in the same publications as authors like Stephen King, Neil Gaiman, Larry Niven, Christine Catherine Rush, Mike Resnick, Tanith Lee, Neal Stephenson, Orson Scott Card, Frank Herbert, and H.P. Lovecraft. It doesn't hurt for Doug to be able to say that his fiction is available in 28 different languages and outside of ebook sales, which are relatively easy for us via Kindle and Kobo, etc., his writing is sold in 22 different countries around the world. Doug actually has great resources on his website at smithwriter.com for this. And if you go to starkreflections.ca and you check the show notes for episode 97, I'll include links to Doug's article on selling foreign market languages, a foreign market language list that he maintains on the website, as well as a link to his book, Playing the Short Game, which is kind of like this episode, an entire book dedicated to short fiction and how Doug has used that to make money. Number four, single story ebooks and themed chapbooks. Now, an ebook doesn't have to be 300 pages bound between two pieces of cloth. It's not restricted by the restrictions of the print book world, and that's magic for a writer. Now, this can go for nonfiction as well. So long-form journalism is another way where people who've written articles and have had them published, if the rights have reverted back to them, they can release them, or they can release unabridged versions of long-form journalism, but the focus here is on short fiction. So when you get the rights back to a story, you can sell it to another market. You can also make it available yourself for, 99 cents as a standalone short story. It can also be a story you sell for, $1.99 or $2.99. Now, depending on the length, most of my single tales, which are, 6,000 words or so, maybe less, I usually sell for 99 cents. But I do have some 10,000 plus word stories that I sell for a bit higher, maybe $1.99 or $2.99. And here's the beauty. It can be a short story, standalone, but it can also be a themed digital chapbook. Now, I call them digital chapbooks because a chapbook was historically something that was produced available for street consumption. Oftentimes it was poets. Poets would put together chapbooks of their poetry, and they might just be 5 or 6 pages folded and stapled together and produced and handed out or sold for pennies. And so chapbooks is also something I learned from Douglas Smith when I was wanting to be nominated or voted for the Aurora Awards here in Canada, where I would take one of my short stories and then I would actually make it into a little booklet and staple it together and hand it out at writers' conferences for free to say, hey, check out my fiction. Here's my website. Go check out some of my other stuff where you can buy my short story, the full short story collection. Here's one sample. But I was also doing that as ways to say, hey, if you've read my story, then you can actually vote. So that would be one way to do that. So taking that concept and using it in a digital fashion, I've created some themed anthologies where I maybe have 3 stories on a theme. So for example, I have Tricky Treater, which are 3 Halloween short stories. They're short stories that I sold to a print small press horror magazine years ago, made my money off of those, and then I repackaged them as Tricky Treats, 3 short stories with the theme of Halloween. Guess what time of year that sells really, really well each year. And again, so going further to that, I've had it available as an ebook as well as other themed collections, but using something like Draft2Digital's print beta, where I only had the front cover designed, Draft2Digital's print data allows you to load the high-res front cover image, and then they'll automatically do a wrap for you, so you don't have to have the full book cover designed, and it looks quite beautiful. Now, you need to have a minimum of 64 pages, but you can use the automated cover. And what I use with those is usually the cost is somewhere in the $3 range, maybe $3.50, $4 after I pay for shipping and everything. But I have a $5 chapbook available at my author table, at conferences, at cons, anywhere that I'm selling books in person, because my traditionally published books are $25. My self-published titles are anywhere between $10 and $18, usually depending on the thickness and the size of them. And this allows me to have a product that includes my fiction that's lower priced. It's just $5. It's relatively inexpensive. So this also creates, of course, a great listing online. So when I'm publishing that and you go and you see the Amazon listing, for example, you see the print book version of Bumps in the Night, which is a collection of short stories meant to be read around a campfire. But you also see there's a print book version and an ebook version and soon to be an audio book version. And one of the things about that is suddenly the ebook, which even if it is $2.99, is showing a lower price than the print and the audio. So again, in that same vein, don't forget audio. Single short stories in audio and digital chapbook audiobooks. Now, using Findaway Voices, I've had huge success with shorter works. One of the benefits of doing a shorter audio work, like a short story or a themed collection of 2 or 3 or 5 short stories on a theme, is that you're paying per hour if you're hiring a professional narrator. And if it is only 1 hour, and even if the rate is $300 an hour, it costs you $300 to produce that audiobook. And suddenly, you have an audiobook. Yes, it's a short audiobook. No, it's not going to sell on Audible. Nobody's going to spend a $15 credit getting a $5 audiobook in that fashion. but I've had huge success and have earned my money back on all the short fiction products that I have done through the library market, through the cost per checkout. And again, I've also done a couple of those books on my own, and it does take less time to produce them if you do them on your own. So again, it's a great way for you to get into the audiobook market using your short fiction in a way that you can either recoup your investment or just make additional revenue. And again, more discoverability for you as a writer because suddenly you have products in three different formats. Number five, Bundle Rabbit. BundleRabbit.com is a place where you can load stories, single short stories, as an independent ebook file, and then it can be curated as part of a manual digital bundle that's created by different curators. So there's this amazing marketplace of stories, and they're tagged by genre, you know, subject code, keywords, things like that. And what curators can do is they can come in and say, I'm looking to do an author collaboration with people who have stories on this particular theme, and then they can go and request your story to be part of it. So just having stories loaded there means that you may be part of it. You can also be requested to add a story to Bundle Rabbit if the person curating it is familiar with your fiction, because let's say they've read one of your stories in an anthology or in some other bundle. And I've had short fiction curated over the years for different bundles that were titled things like Crimes, Capers, and Rule Breakers, Haunted, Halloween Haunted Horde, Very Merry Christmas. And I also curated my own bundle last year in 2018 called Books Gone Bad, where I used Active Reader, which is about a 12 to 14,000 word digital chapbook, and I mentioned chapbooks in item number four in this podcast, and I included Active Reader because they're all stories about books or specifically writers and their books, and I was looking for other stories or novellas that would fit into this theme, even some full-length books as well, and I did the Books Gone Bad, and the way it's set up is everybody gets a cut from that, and the beautiful thing about it is the curator just gets their cut, and then each independent contributor gets their cut. But further to that, that's a regular bundle on Bundle Rabbit, but there's this new opportunity, or relatively new because it's only been there for about a year and a half, is you can go in and create an anthology. So instead of taking these separate ebook files that are loaded and curating them, and basically Bundle Rabbit does all the hard work of merging them into a single EPUB file that they send to all of the downstream vendors, so Kindle, Apple, Kobo, Nook, etc. When you're doing an anthology, you actually use that to build your anthology. And so I've been a part of a couple of anthologies. Jamie Ferguson's one of the editors of the anthology, and there's a series that Jamie and Deanna, her co-editor, are doing called Amazing Monster Tales, sort of classic pulp monster stories. And the very first one was, the theme for that one was called Dawn of the Monsters. And for that, I gave them The Ritual of the Drawing, which was a reprint story of mine. And for the second book, Monster Road Trip, in that series, which is still forthcoming, they're in the process of editing it right now, I wrote a short story in my Canadian Werewolf in New York series. It ended up being a 22,000 word short story, and I did it specifically because they were looking for stories about monsters on road trips, and since I have Michael Andrews as a werewolf trapped on a train, and he's going to turn into a wolf while stuck on the train, thought that would be a fun monster road trip. So again, the beauty of this for anyone who's thinking about putting together an anthology is you can do an ebook anthology, and of course, authors or creators, there are creators like Lynn Worthen who has done anthologies this way, but then has actually then also created a print anthology. But the nice thing about this for ebooks, for Bundle Rabbit, is that they do all the hard work. They take the file, you use Bundle Rabbit. When you set up an anthology, you can set up to say that, let's say you have 10 contributors and everybody gets 10%. Or usually the editor keeps a little bit more because obviously they've done extra work. And maybe you get a big name author to agree to come into your anthology. Well, potentially the big name author, because they're going to be the draw that draws a lot of people to buy this book on Amazon and the other websites, maybe the big name author gets 25% and everyone else gets 6%. But the beautiful thing about this is it's yet another property that has one of my short stories out there that's listed at all the retailers. I don't need to do anything. The editor, once the book is done, or the curator, once all that work is done, they don't need to do anything. What happens is the money comes back in and Bundle Rabbit handles cutting it up and sending the money directly to your account. Number six, creating unique newsletter reader magnets. Now, a critical element for author marketing is having a newsletter, having a regular way for you to connect with your biggest fans. Now, one of the going methodologies for getting people to sign up for your newsletter is offering them a free book. Sometimes you don't always have a free book. You may not have enough books out there that you can afford to give one away for free. And here's where using a short story as a reader magnet can be a really unique thing, particularly for your biggest fans. So while it's great to have a newsletter, and the fundamental reason that you want a newsletter is you want to be in control of reaching out to the people who want to know when your next work is coming out, or to connect with you or find out more about you because they've read one of your pieces, they've read one of your stories, they've read one of your novels, and they want to find out more about you. Giving away a free book for the sake of giving away a free book may attract more freegans than actual fans. So people who are just there for the free book and they don't actually care about you, they don't care about the things you write, they just want a free book. And unfortunately, lots of newsletters are filled with those kinds of fans. But if you want to get something that attracts the people who actually like your writing, maybe they like the universe you're writing in or something from the series you're writing or one of the standalone books you're writing, is create a unique short story that's just for your fans. So let's say you have a standalone novel, you don't have a series, but there's a scene you cut out or a character that you had to not explain the backstory of. Maybe you've written a short story specifically about that minor character and their full story arc backstory. Well, that may be something that people who've read that book are interested in. And if they like that side character, they want more of that side character, they can only get the story if they subscribe to your newsletter. So again, using a custom written short story just specifically to get people to download your newsletter or sign up for your newsletter because they can't purchase it, they can't download it anywhere, that's the only way they can get it, may be a way to ensure that for your mailing list, you're getting the right people, the fans who actually care about you and the things that you're writing. The two most common newsletter tools that authors use may be something like MailChimp or AWeber. I'm not going to get into the tech of that, but at least explain the importance of using short fiction as a marketing tool there. Number seven, using short fiction as a funnel. So very similar to the reader magnets, using a short story ebook, as we talked about earlier, and publishing that to the retail platforms. Maybe it's connected to a standalone book. Maybe it's connected to a longer worker series. Again, it may be like that custom unique story that is for your fans, but you make it available everywhere. Again, this could be a backstory. It could be an origin story. It could be a prequel story to a novel. And I'll give an example that I've used is my novel, A Canadian Werewolf in New York, which is supposed to be a series, and I haven't yet finished book two, standard problem for some authors. I have a story that's a 10,000 word short story that was the original story I wrote that ended up becoming the book, getting transferred into a book. But what I have is I have this time around as a short story that's meant to be a hook. It's free on most ebook platforms. It may not be free on Amazon or all Amazon sites because they may not have price matched it everywhere. So it's at least 99 cents there. But what happens is people read it for free. And at the end of that short story, at the end of that ebook, there's a link that says, if you really like this character in this universe, there's a full novel. And I explained in that case that the full novel kind of, this is really only chapters 1 through 3 in the novel that become the short story. If you want to find out what happens in the rest of Michael's day, although the short story is a self-contained story, you can kind of find out what happens next. And so again, you can use a short story in that way, publishing to the various retailers as a way to get people interested in your books. And this could be particularly useful if you do not have a series or if you only have standalone books. It might be one way of getting them hooked on your writing so they want to go and pick up a full book. Number 8, free online. So again, I'm going to drop on the same concept of short fiction that instead of publishing it as an ebook and uploading it to Bundle Rabbit or uploading it as a free or uploading it as something that you can sell, maybe you use the short fiction as something that you post on your website, on your blog, on your author page. Maybe you use a platform like Wattpad.com and you use that to gain an audience. You can even use that as a testing ground. You can use that. Wattpad, for example, gives you really amazing analytics as to who is reading this. So male, female, age, and where in the world they are. So when you're looking at marketing, you can maybe use that to understand, wow, the majority of the people who read this short story, which is very similar to the genre for the full-length book, similar thing that I have, you understand a little bit more about the demographics. So when you're doing ads, you can use that as a leverage. Similarly, for online, you can do audio recordings. You can release an audio file of you reading the story. You can release that as a podcast. Terry Follis, who was a guest on this podcast, basically released his very first self-published book as an audiobook podcast and generated a huge following of thousands of people around the world, many of which went on to have to buy the book. And I was one of them. And since then, I've bought every single book Terry has published. He's now traditionally publishing because he landed a contract. You can go back and listen to the episode he was in. I can't remember the number, but there'll be a link in the show notes. So you can use audio recordings, or you could use live video. So you can use YouTube, you can use Instagram Live, Facebook Live, either any other video live source where you can actually get that sort of buzz to get people to want to click, hey, so-and-so is doing a live video right now, click here now, and you see those pop-ups on different social media apps, or maybe it's something that you actually record and push out there. Again, this can be you reading your short fiction, because sometimes people are auditory, sometimes they're visual, and that may be one way of getting their attention. Now, I did a long experiment with Free Friday Frights. It was hashtag Free Friday Frights. And if you go to marklesley.ca/Free Friday Frights, you'll see that I have an archive of every Friday I had been doing either a free short story that I would read and then post online for a week. And every week I would replace it. I changed that to monthly because running the podcast, doing the Free Friday Frights, trying to do all the consulting I do as well as writing was just too much. So I had to give something up and I gave that up. But I do occasionally dip back into it because I really enjoy that experience, because it's also good practice for you as a writer if you're not comfortable doing readings. And I love doing readings, but at least the Free Friday Fright gives me the opportunity to practice the readings or even practice some of the stories that I'm going to be doing in front of a live audience. And hey, if it's terrible, you can always delete it afterwards. So again, online is a way you can share these short stories, and that's more marketing and author branding for you. Number 9, using location-based apps. And I'm thinking of things like Foursquare/Swarm or Squirrel. And I remember this back from, and this is Ashley Gardner, who's now at Wattpad and was at Kobo for a while when I was at Kobo. And initially, I think one of the first times I worked with her in the industry is I was a bookseller and she was working at Dundurn. I hadn't yet been published by Dundurn, but she was a marketing manager at Dundurn Publishing. And she talked about using Foursquare and going in. It's a place where you check into different places. And I use the app pretty religiously, where I like to check in because I like to look back and see, wow, I was here 3 years ago and it was the last time I was here. And sometimes when you check in on an app like that, you get free things. So check into the Lego store. If you show it to them that you've checked in on that social media app, they'll give you a special treat or a toy that's only available for people who check in. I remember I was at a bar in Manhattan and got a free cocktail. I got a free martini at this martini bar because I checked in. So again, I'm always eager to check in just to see what's going on. But what I have done, and I started this with Haunted Hamilton. So Hamilton, Ontario City, a book of ghost stories. What I did is I went into Foursquare, and at Dundurn Castle, which is allegedly haunted, I went in and I just did a couple lines from the novel, or from the nonfiction book, I should say, and then quoted that. This is from chapter 6 of the novel. And then I went to the courthouse, which is now, I guess, I don't know what it's being turned into. McMaster University owned it for a while, and I'm not sure if it's being turned into condos. But, you know, the courthouse was haunted because people had been hung there. And then there's some old hotels downtown. There's a whole bunch of the armories, all these different locations. The Winking Judge, for example. I was just looking at the app on the Winking Judge because I just lost my mayorship at the Winking Judge, which is a fantastic bar in Hamilton, Ontario. And when I was looking at it, up popped up the note that I left, which was a line from the book Haunted Hamilton, which is how I discovered that. Now, Squirrel is a similar app that's meant specifically for discoverability of books, and it doesn't have to be nonfiction. So with Squirrel, for example, I used quotes and scenes from my novel, A Canadian Werewolf in New York. So Michael wakes up at the beginning of the novel in Battery Park, completely naked, and he's trying to figure out, how am I going to find some clothes so I can, you know, get home without people seeing me running around butt naked. And so, you know, I have a line or two of text from the opening scene in Battery Park. I have him going on the Letterman show. Was at the Ed Sullivan Theater, which is not the Ed, it's not the Ed Sullivan show, the David Letterman show. It's not that any longer, but that building is still there. So when he's checking into the Algonquin Hotel, which is a historic hotel in Manhattan, that's where Michael lives, I have a note there. So if you ever go on Squirrel or even on Foursquare, you check in, you may actually see a line from one of my books. So you can use short fiction connections with location-based apps in that similar fashion, because that can be a trigger for somebody to go and find one of those funnels that you get out there. And again, that's using the fiction, using shorter pieces of fiction for marketing. Number 10. Micro stories and flash fiction. So this is a kind of short fiction. So I'm thinking about when you think about that classic story from Hemingway, allegedly from Hemingway, that is the micro story that says, "For sale, baby shoes, never worn." That's a micro story. It says a lot in just those 6 words. That's the kind of thing I'm thinking of with flash fiction, although flash fiction can be 100 words, etc. Can be postcard fiction. Think of Twitter fiction or Instagram fiction or poetry. So again, really, really short clips or scenes that you can use to share in social media or even in a physical environment on a postcard, for example. Now, I'm going to give you an example. I think it was like 2008, 2009. There were actually markets where you could sell stories on Twitter. And I had made, it was the most money I ever made per word. You know, if you think of 5 or 6 cents a word as professional rates, and I think you'd get $1 for a Twitter story. So it's kind of like, wow, that's the most money I made per word. And here's one of the stories I sold to Tweet the Meat, which was looking for horror shorts. Here's the story. "It wasn't me," Carl said. "My shadow killed him." The detective smiled. "Your shadow will rot in prison, but we need you to keep it there." That's it. That's the story. I sold it. Made money off of that. Other story that I sold to this market was, "I wanted it like it used to be, Mom," Jim sobbed. Her body was nearly ripped in two. Trying to crawl back into her womb wasn't a good idea. So again, those were two micro stories that I sold into a Twitter market, and their stories, and they're gruesome and dark and disturbing. And again, you know, that's kind of similar to some of the short fiction that I write. So you can use something like that to basically lead back to your website, to lead back to your other markets. But again, it's another way of using short fiction, micro short fiction, to attract people back to your universe. So those are 10 ideas that you can use for making money off of short fiction or marketing using short fiction. But I have three bonus ideas that I'm going to share with you really, really quickly. Number 11, custom story. Write a custom story. I actually killed people for a few hundred dollars. It was for charity. This was the tie-in with initially my blog novel, which was initially a blog and then became the novel I Death, which was published by a traditional publisher. I have done multiple occurrences because the main character in I Death has a death curse and people he becomes close to die. And so what I did is I would kill people for a few hundred dollars. I did, this was for the Hamilton Literacy Council, where it was actually advertised in the local newspaper. So again, it was really good marketing for me and the other books that I had out there. Now, back in the day, I didn't have many books out there. But it was an opportunity for me to sit down with the person who won the contest because they paid money. Now, that money went to support a great cause, and I would learn their greatest fear. I would learn a little bit about them, and then I would write a custom story where they would meet Peter, my main character, and I would kill them in the story. And two of the people that I killed for charity ended up in the novel I Death. I got their permission to do that. I even did a custom short story that I wrote for a con, a mini con in Niagara Falls, New York. And again, it was a People and Things auction. So I auctioned off the chance to get killed by me. And what I did is I released a print chapbook of the story where I killed one of the attendees who paid money that went to the con. And that became a short story that was collateral damage. So it was initially done as I printed 100 copies of this short story that I made available, limited to 100 copies. And I made that available to people at the con. And of course, the guy who won, he got 10 copies of it so he could give it to his friends and show people how he got killed in a story. And then, of course, it became an ebook that I made available for free to link people back in to I Death. But again, think about the possibility of what you could do with your talent and your skill if you're a romance writer. What about writing a custom romance story for someone? Again, this is just a different way that's not about selling books on Amazon or Kobo or Apple or any of those other places. It's about writing a custom story and having someone pay you to write a custom story for them. Think about that as an idea for short fiction. Number 12, Patreon subscription. So again, thinking about that same idea where you're creating content specifically for people who are paying you for that. So think about this. Short fiction, you wanted to do some stuff, you make it available only to a select and specific audience. There is a promise of regular feeding of a type of story, stories from a universe, story that follows characters or a town or whatever it is that you're writing and whatever genre you're writing that your readers like and they resonate with and they love, and that's written custom for them on a specific schedule and only available to them, or potentially available to them way before it's available on the regular market. And that's another way you can leverage short fiction for earning money. Number 13, as a special gift. This is less of a way to make money, but maybe more of a way to save money. I remember when I was first, in the first few years I was in a bookseller, there was a manager of one of the Smith books that I knew back in Ottawa, and he'd wanted to be a writer. He'd never actually released a full-length book that I'm aware of, but he wrote this amazing Christmas story that was about a manager at a bookstore at Christmas time, of course, and it was a horror story. And he wrote it specifically to give to his family members for Christmas. He wanted them to have something special and unique in his voice, and it was something that he could do. So, you know, in the similar way that somebody who has a crochet stuff makes you a beautiful mittens or hat or something like that, or knits you a sweater or does something like that, think about using your talent as a writer to create a special gift for someone. It could be a special gift for family, for friends, for a special occasion. And I'm not talking about doing that just because you're cheap, but think about the time and energy that you spend in writing something specially. Let's say it's your your parents' 75th birthday, and you write something really special, which is the story of their life that you've taken some time and you've put that together, or it's a fictionalized version of something for your best friend's 30th birthday, and you share this unique story of some fantasy that they had always had. They had always wanted to go skydiving, so you create a skydiving story about them, and you give that to them as a special gift. Thinking about the heart and the soul and all the things you put into that. Again, not talking about being cheap, but just thinking about leveraging your talent to give someone something that's special. You imagine how many people they're going to share that with. And when they say, oh yeah, my friend, my daughter, my cousin, my nephew, my whatever, they're a writer and they wrote this story for me. I wrote a short story for my, I call her my niece, although she's technically my cousin, Madison. And Maddie's now, you know, she's just going off to her first year of university now. But I wrote a short story for Madison when she was little. She's my godchild as well. I adore this beautiful young woman. She's an amazing person. And when she was young, she had, there was some reason why she wanted to, I think she had a stuffed animal and it was a cow. Or it was a horse, and she named it Cow. And there was also another story from previous about the concept of a horse that thinks he's a cow or wanted to be a cow. And so I wrote this short story called A Horse Named Cow. And my good friend Kimberly Footit, who I've co-written some fiction with, she actually is also an artist, so she illustrated it for me. And I made a single book. I don't even have a copy of the book. I made a single color book for her. A Horse Named Cow, which was a story about Maddie, Madison, and her horse named Cow. It's a beautiful little story. But again, it's a gift that I hope that she still cherishes, because I loved spending time working on that and thinking about adding all these fun elements from her life into that gift. So it's another way you can use short fiction as a way for, in this particular case, it's more of caring for someone or giving something special to someone. And who knows what that leads to. So that's the end of episode 97 of the podcast. Thanks so much for listening. I hope that somewhere in those 10 to 13 tips or ideas, hopefully you heard me say something that either resonated with you and gave you an idea, or maybe even better yet, I said something that made you think about something completely new that you would add as number 14 for making money off of short fiction, or potentially using short fiction to market you and your author brand. I would encourage anyone, if you have any ideas that were sparked from listening to this episode, please go over to starkreflections.ca and share your ideas. What did it make you think of? What are some ideas that you can use? Because again, that may benefit other people who are listening to the podcast. Again, this is Mark Leslie Lefebvre. This was a solo episode of the Stark Reflections podcast, episode 97, Tips on Short Fiction, Marketing, and Making Money. Thank you so much for listening to the podcast. I hope you enjoyed this, hope you got some value out of it, and I hope you return next week for episode 98. So until next week and next episode, this is Mark Leslie Lefebvre wishing you great writing and good Stark Reflections.
Thank you for listening to the Stark Reflections podcast. You can find show notes for each episode at starkreflections.ca.
The music for this podcast, Laser Groove, was composed and produced by Kevin MacLeod. Check out more of Kevin's great music at incomptech.com.